Welcome to Words of Aloha with Pastor Isy Manzo of Amazing Grace Ministries International. We're headquartered in Kailua-Kona on the Big Island of Hawaii. Join us now as we get into God's Word.
Lord, we thank you for this beautiful day. We thank you for each person here that's listening, Lord, and we just pray now that you would have your way with us, Lord. You are the potter and we're the clay now. We pray that you use Pastor Isy to encourage us, Lord, to open up your word and make it real and living, Lord, that we can apply it to our life and change the way that we walk day after day. Mm-hmm. We ask you to do that now in Jesus' name. And all God's people said,
amen.
Amen.
All right, guys, let's turn in your Bibles to Romans chapter 5 as we're going to conclude the chapter today, beginning in verse 12, where we're picking up with a therefore. Now, if you were with us before, you know every time that the Apostle Paul puts a therefore in the scripture, your question is supposed to be, what is that therefore? What? Therefore. And I know it sounds silly, but we learned this in Bible school, and it has stuck with me ever since, that therefore being an associative conjunctive in English school, they taught us that. And it means it associates the previous idea with the idea that is going to follow. In other words, because something be true, or because of this fact, we can therefore build or surmise or continue with that train of thought. Now, I like the Apostle Paul because he has this gift of just laying it out systematically. Like, for my faith, it, you know, some people, they go to churches and they're taught, an approach to their Christian experience that is a very emotional approach. And so they're urged sometimes even to just shut off your brain. Don't worry about thinking about it. Just see how you feel. And I hesitate to tell you this, but in the scripture we're commanded, and even Jesus was tested by an attorney. He was saying, what's the greatest commandment of the whole of the law? And Jesus asked him, well, how's it read to you? And he said, love the Lord your God. Right from Deuteronomy, love the Lord your God with all of what? Your heart, so your emotions are included. But not just your emotions, all of your heart, all of your what? Your mind, all of your soul, which is your spirit, that spirit part of you that makes you unique, and all of your strength. It covers every dimension of our being. I mean, our body, our mind, our spirit, and our heart. And so, he said the second command is like unto the first. Love your neighbor as what? Yourself. Now, some people don't like me to remind them of this, but they're like, well, can I love my neighbor with my mind, you know, brotherly love. I acknowledge they're another person on the planet. I have to put up with them sucking air too, but I don't really like them. Do I have to love them with my heart? You know, can I separate it? Well, the first command, it says, is like unto, or likened to the first. If I have to love God with every part of my being, well, how am I supposed to love my neighbor then? Just, I only get to use part? I don't get to, no. It's a package deal. He wants you to love with a full love, like the way he loved it. And Bible, if you don't know, the Bible tells us that when we didn't know how to love, God showed us his love, his unconditional love. He didn't say, I'll love you when you get it together. I'll love you if you're right and perfect in my eyes. And we went over that last week. Can any of us be righteous in our own strength? You know, there's a scripture in the Old Testament that says, our righteousness is as filthy rags. We don't have righteousness that we could stand before God and say, I am perfect, God, accept me. In fact, the Bible teaches, we just went over it in Romans 3:23, that all of us have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. But Paul has pointed that out so he could say, but there was one who lived righteously. There was one that fulfilled the requirement of the law and became a living sacrifice on our behalf. And who was that? Jesus. That's when people say, why are you so into Jesus? I said, maybe you haven't read about him or you don't know. But this guy came into this world, it says, as he was God, he was with God. We read in John chapter 1, that in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word what? was God. And you continue to read chapter 1 of John, the Gospel of John, and you see, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. Now, when he was born, we went over this last week. Remember at the nativity scene, the angels before, you know, when we were kids, we always had put up a little nativity, and the shepherds were in the field waiting, and the angels came and said, this day there has been born a Savior, a child. And he's gonna, you'll find him laying wrapped in cloth and lying in what? In a hotel. No, a hospital built for him. No, in a manger. For some people, they don't know what a manger is because they didn't grow up on a farm. But what is a manger? It's a feeding trough. I mean, if I could have tried to get my wife to put our oldest into a feeding trough, this would not have flown at all. I mean, we did put her in a drawer and a suitcase, that's right. We were stuck over in Honolulu. She was born over there, and we wound up going, what are we going to do? We opened the suitcase. It was the only thing that had sides that could hold. We put blankets all around and made a little travel bassinet. That's just creative parenting for you ones that might have to come up with this. We just used a suitcase and made a little bassinet out of it. But Jesus didn't even have that great of accommodations. He got a feeding trough. I mean, if you've been on a farm and you've seen animals eat, and you put, yeah, oh, there is nothing to be envious about how Jesus came into this world. And yet it says he humbled himself to become a man so that we wouldn't feel like we couldn't approach him. And he was called by the angel. They said, you shall call his name Emmanuel. And Emmanuel translates to, do you guys know this? God, El for Elohim, and Iman, it means to God be with us. That's what it is. It's he came to be with us. Because so many people, they have a really good question in their mind. If there's a real God, why doesn't he show himself to us? He's God. Why does he reveal that he's there? And the answer is, he did. It's a very big deal. He already did. And because he did, we changed the whole way we keep calendars. AD, BC, you know, growing up, you remember that on the calendar? What was that whole thing, BC, before Crayolas? Before cookies, right? No, it's before Christ. And AD, Latin for Anni Domini, is the year of the Lord. Anni is a year, and Domini is the master, the Lord, the dominant one from Latin. The year of the Lord. And from that point, we mark time that God did come to be with us. Now, do you guys know that that's recognized all around the globe? That AD, BC, that's a pretty big deal. So when someone says to you, I wish God would just show himself that he's really there, you just have to remind them. Sometimes it just takes a little reminder. You've seen that thing on the calendar, right? That AD, BC thing. And I always like to play dumb. What was that BC thing? And they'll tell you. Before Christ, I thought you were a Christian, man. That's right. But if it could change all the calendars around the globe, don't you think that it's something really important? That God wanted us to know that he really did come to be with us? He sent his son. Now, what did we do to his son, this perfect one that was sent? We just welcomed him with open arms and glad you're here, take over. We need an uncorrupt guy to rule the place, right? No, they were calling him king. Remember, they did cry Hosanna, and they threw down the palm branches, and as he was riding in on a donkey and saying, Hosanna, Hosanna, which means save now. You're the one that has the power. Hosanna in the highest. And you could only cry that to someone who had authority. This conjugation, Hosanna, is saying, save now, to like a king authority, someone who could save us from all this trouble. And the Pharisees said, tell your disciples, shut up. You know, they're blaspheming. Jesus, I tell you, if they remain quiet, the very rocks, and if you've been to Israel, you know they got a lot of rocks, just like the big island. So the very stones would cry out, this day has to happen that I come to be revealed to my children, Israel. Now, when he gets there, he cries. He weeps over them. He said, Jerusalem, Jerusalem. You know, I would to gather you like a hen gathers its chicks under its wings, but you don't have it. You don't want any part of it. And what did they do to Jesus? We know. They crucified him. And then they put him in the tomb. But 3 days later, we know the rest of the story. He rose. And when he rose, he made the payment complete for our sins. Now, this is where we pick up in the book what Paul is writing to the church at Rome. He's writing this epistle, this letter, to the church at Rome, and he's telling them, guys, Christ has done something so great for us. I mean, so great that we can rejoice in this. And he's going to explain, because Christ has done this, demonstrated his love toward us. Look at verse 8 of the chapter, just so I can do the therefore thing. He said, God demonstrated his own love toward us, that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Not when we get it together. Don't ever go with that. Someone tells you, well, when I get together, then I'll go to church with you. Because you know what they're saying. I'm never going to church with you. I mean, if they say they're going to wait till they get it together to go to church, come on. Let you tell them, don't bother. Not don't bother coming. Don't bother waiting till you get it together, because Christ did not make that a requirement. While we were yet sinners, at the right time, Christ died for us. And he justified. Now, what was justified? Just as if I'd what? Never sinned. He justified us by his blood, so that we would be saved from the wrath of God to come. Now, that's a pretty big deal. And so Paul's going to go on this idea and say, now have been reconciled, brought back into favor with God because of Christ's offering, and we've been saved by his life. And not only this, verse 11 says, but we also get to exult in God through the Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we receive the reconciliation. Therefore, just as through one man, sin entered the world, and it spread. Death through that sin spread to all men, because all sinned. He says, for until the law, sin was in the world, but sin was not imputed. When there is no law, you can't arrest them and say you broke the law if there's no law. It's like saying there's no speed limit, and can we pull you over for speeding? No, there's no rule that says you can't speed. Does that mean you can't drive dangerously and endanger people by driving too fast? You can still do stupid stuff with your car. You don't need a rule that says don't do stupid stuff, because we just do stupid stuff. I mean, it's just part of the way we're wired. But until there is a law that says this is the speed limit, you're not supposed to go faster than this, or you're not supposed to do some reckless behavior, unless the law says it, we can't impute that sin. We can't arrest you for doing that reckless driving or that speeding. So how long was man on the earth without the law of God given? When was the law given? Who got the commandments up on the mountain? You guys remember the story, right? Yul Brynner, Charlton Heston. I'm just going back. I'm dating myself, right? You guys, the Ten Commandments, remember this? And he goes up, Charlton Heston goes up on the mountain, the burning bush, comes back with his two tablets, right? Who was that guy's name that he was portraying? Moses. Okay, Moses. But see, if you study what the Bible tells us, the genealogy leading up to Moses, you got a whole bunch of characters between Adam till you get to Moses. You got a span of a couple thousand years. What men were on this earth, and do you think men ever did anything that would endanger another man during that time? Like, was there the law, one of the laws on the right-hand side of the tablet, as we look at it, well, in Hebrew you read from right to left. Sorry, on this left side, your right, would be the ones that relate between us and our fellow man. The first four commandments are on one side, the six are on another side. I know you're used to seeing five and five in English. It's not how it is in Hebrew. But the first four commandments have to do with you, your relationship between you and who? God. The six other ones had to do with your relationship between you and your fellow man. So I always call one, the tablet, the first tablet, which in Hebrew you start on the right, has four of them. Those are the ones that deal with you and God, your vertical relationship between you and the Lord. The horizontal relationships you have down here on this planet, they're on the other tablet. One of the ones on that side says, thou shalt not kill. It was put down as, now we're writing this rule. Thou shalt not kill. Had anyone killed before Moses? How it turned to Genesis, the very first, the two brothers, Cain and Abel, right? Adam's kids. One of them kills the other one. Just, But there was no law that said thou shalt not kill. Now, was it still wrong to kill? Sure. We just couldn't arrest him for it yet. Hadn't broke a law because the law hadn't been given. But see, sin still was already in the world. Lying was already going on. You know, when the Lord came into the garden and said, so Adam, what happened? You know, he said, I was ashamed. I was hiding. Why were you ashamed? Because I'm naked. Who told you you were naked? Remember when the Lord created them in the garden? They weren't ashamed. It says they were naked, but they weren't ashamed because they hadn't sinned yet. See, but the Bible tells us what happens, right? Adam and Eve are there, and the serpent says, I'm going to tempt her, and then she's going to go to her husband and get him, and they're going to go in. And as soon as they do the one thing, remember the Lord told them, you get to have, he puts him in the garden. Here you are, Adam. You're in this perfect garden made by God. Now, guys, I do want to take this up with Adam when they get there. Because it says there was no thorns, no thistles, the garden was all planted by God. And God creates Adam, and it says he brought all the animals to him, and he names all the animals, and then he says it's not good for man to be alone, so he makes a helper suitable, and he puts him to sleep, takes a rib, and makes Eve. Eve in Hebrew means living. Living. It's beautiful, actually, a name in has meaning. It's to that she would be the mother of all living is the idea of her name. So Adam and Eve are in the garden, and they have one command from God. Be fruitful and what? Multiply. I love it when people say, God's uptight with sex. I said, wait a minute, I think he made it. Pretty sure. There was a design from the beginning. And he put a man, a naked man, and a naked woman, they're not ashamed because they weren't in sin, in a beautiful garden in paradise, and said, here's the rule. My command, be fruitful and multiply. And then there was one tree he put in the garden called the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And he gave them one do not. One do, be fruitful and multiply. One do not. What was the do not? Do not eat from that tree. In the day that you eat from that tree, you'll know the difference between good and evil. Your conscience is going to be could you imagine they had a totally clear conscience? Anybody think that would be cool? I mean, not standing there going, oh, I'm conscientious that I'm naked because, you know, I'm standing here. There was no sin. They didn't even have to worry about that. They're in this perfect garden. There's no thorns, no thistles, no weeds to have to mess with in the garden. I mean, that's a gardener's dream. Ask my dear Alfred over here who comes and helps me at my house. I built a rock wall. We live on a corner lot. It dropped off from our doorway, our front door, to the sidewalk, 13 feet 7 inches. Declined in the space of about 20 feet. So, you know, almost a straight 45 degree out our front door to the sidewalk. Now, my kids, when we first moved in, they loved it. Mom did not, but they did. Because the guy we bought the house from, he was retired. He didn't want to do yard work. So he put visqueen plastic all over the whole hill. And then he put gravel sprinkled on top of the plastic. Planted a few plumeria trees on the side of the hill. That was it. Low maintenance yard, right? But do you know what kids see when they see Steve Jai like this with plastic with gravel on top? Slides. And I would come home, there'd be black streaks in the front of the yard. Trail from the door all the way, and piles of gravel on the sidewalk, and I have to go out there and shovel back up on the hill. And I'm thinking, who did this crazy thing? So I got the idea. I watched a guy building a rock wall next door to put a pool in, and he had the same hill, but they put a wall and they terraced it and they made it stay up there, you know. And so I said, I'll work with you if you'll teach me how to do that. I'll be your grunt laborer so you can show me how to do that. I grew up, you know, my grandfather's a master tile setter, a mason from Italy. And so, but I knew how to do block work, but not rock work. So I want to learn how to do this. Can you show me? He's like, okay. So I go work for him, and then I tell him, I don't tell him I want to build like a giant thing. I'm gonna build my wife a little herb garden on the back wall, like just 2 foot high wall, because the ground is like, I could make it a little this deep. She could put the oregano and the basil and all the stuff we need to cook with, you know. I'm gonna make a nice long garden along the back. And so he comes back there and helps me put the strings. We get it all done. I learn how to do this. That was just the precursor, because in my mind I was gonna build retaining wall on the front curve, get rid of that whole thing. I'm gonna step it up, go up 5 feet, step in 2 feet, go up, step in, go make a flat yard. I'm from Arizona. We have flat. Not too much flat here on a lot of the house lots. So I'm gonna fix it. I didn't know it would take 3.5 years. Also didn't know I go from 128 pounds to about 198 pounds from lifting rocks on my spare time. But you do. You get bigger lifting, you know. I wonder how those Tongans can move this big rock. I finally got to where I could move them. I was like, this is fun. Before, a little push, it wouldn't move. Got bigger. Oh, look, it moves. And I made these gardens, and I was so proud. I'm building the whole thing. I'm going to plumb it with drip irrigation. Who has time to water? I'm going to put it in while I build the walls. I'm going to make the pipes go under, figure it all out, put all this stuff. And I worked really hard. Now, this is a 3.5-year project, so you know I had time to think out all the details. I got it all done, and I planted asparagus on the big run of the curve. So I've got a 125-foot run by 2 feet of asparagus. 250 square feet. I'm going to have asparagus. It's so expensive. I'll just grow my own. And in Hawaii, it goes like, not like on the mainland where you have one crop. Sometimes you get what they call the second sprouting, and then it goes dormant because winter hits, and, you know, you got to cover it up, try to keep it alive. Here, we get 3 sproutings a year. Like 3 times, it doesn't know. There's no winter. It doesn't go to sleep. And I love it, man. It's like, oh, right, I'm gonna have asparagus galore. And I get the root crowns. I order some from the mainland. I plant them. I get the asparagus coming up, and I'm thinking, I got the drip irrigation. I got it all figured out. And the one thing I didn't think about, weeds. Weeds. That garden fills up so fast with weeds. And Alfred comes over. He helps me pull all the weeds, get it all back to all beautiful. The asparagus, he trims it all nice, starts just going crazy. I'm like, yeah. And then I come back out two weeks later. And those weeds are overgrowing the asparagus plants. You know, asparagus grows real slow. To get it established takes a long time. Once you do, you got like a 25-year crop. A garden, they'll go, if you take care of about 25 years, the plants. But they take a long time. They grow real slow and spread real slow. And those weeds, they don't need slow. They get like, if you don't get around and do it, and poor Alfred starts at one end, and he works his way down, and I swear, by the time he gets to the other end, he's back to the beginning, starting over. He's like, man, I just did this, but I'm, you know. Can you imagine being in a garden made by God with no weeds? It's paradise. I mean, and they're just told, just be fruitful and multiply. And Adam, why did you have to do this? Why did you have to? I mean, because you guys know when he sinned, what happened? They got booted from the garden, right? They get booted out of the garden. And the Bible said sin entered into this world through their act of sin. Because one man sinned, it said now it brought death. And see, once that death occurred, Adam no longer could pass life. His wife, Eve, living, mother of living, is now not passing life because a part of them died. When they disobeyed, what part died? There's something in them that died. The spirit. The spirit that had that sensitivity to the living God. That part died. In fact, that's why Jesus, when he appeared, he said to Nicodemus, he said, unless a man be born again, he can't see the things of the kingdom of God. He can't enter the kingdom of God. And Nicodemus went, what? What's this mean? She said, you're a teacher of Israel? And you don't understand this? And he goes, well, do I go back in my mother's womb a second time? And Nicodemus, you're a little big for that. You know, full-grown man, do I get back in my mother's womb? What a stupid question. Jesus, I'm not talking about being born physically. That what was born of water, he says, is water. That's the you know, the breaking of the water sac when the baby's born, or the mom's water breaks. He said, that was born of water is water. But that which is born of spirit is spirit. You need a second birth, a birth of your spirit. And because Adam and Eve had died from their disobedience in sin, death, it said, spread to all men. They couldn't pass on that spiritual life. So that's why Christ had to come, that he would be the one to bring the antidote to that death. He would bring the life back to us. And this is now what Paul is going to zero in on. As he's sitting here, he says, listen, guys, the work what he has done, just as though through one man sin has entered this world, death through sin, so death spread to all men because all sinned. Now he says, until the law, there was sin in the world, but it was not imputed where there was no law. But nevertheless, death reigned from Adam until Moses, even over those that had not sinned in the likeness of Adam's offense, who was a type of him to come. Adam is a type. In the Jewish culture, they like these studies that you do called types and shadows. You explain truths with them. They're very, you have to use your mind, by the way. You cannot do this one on feeling. You got to employ gray matter. So love the Lord with all your mind on this. He says, there is a type of the Adam who is to come. Now, the first Adam, and I'm going to tell you about the first Adam because I cheated. I read over a different passage in Corinthians where it describes the same thing, what Paul's writing here, but with a little more detail. I'll go to it in a minute. But he says here, first, the free gift. Verse 15, but the free gift is not like the transgression. For if by the transgression of one, many died, well, much more did the grace of God and the gift by the grace of the one man, Jesus Christ, abound to many. If one guy sinning could pass death to everyone, what could one guy doing righteousness do? See, this is what Paul's going to explain. See, because people, they have good questions. You know, well, it seems like everyone has sinned. I mean, that doesn't even, I really haven't run into anyone when I go over that verse, all of us have sinned and fall short. I haven't run into anyone go, no, I haven't done it. If they said that, I'd say, well, you just sinned right there. You lied. You know? Oh, no, not me. You're blind with your pride and arrogance then. Let's throw that in too. Sin two. And if you let them open their mouth anymore, they're going to be piling up sin three, sin four. I mean, there's no way that any of us have not sinned. That's not the problem. It's what do? We all know that we sinned. Even as it's just part of our nature. We know it. But see, if through one man sin could be introduced to the world, Paul is going to point out, if one man could mess it up for all of us, what could one Son of God do for all of us? This is important detail, right? I mean, if one guy could mess up the thing, can one who comes as a man, and by the way, that's why he's referred to as the second Adam, this Christ, could he fix what the other guy did? And Paul's going to point out, he can not only do it, he can do even better. He can fix all. Look at, he said, the free gift's not like the transgression. If by the transgression of one the many died, much more did the grace of God, verse 15, and the gift by the grace of the one man, Jesus Christ, abound to many. Now the gift is not like that which came through the one who sinned, verse 16 says, for on the one hand judgment arose, for one transgression resulting in condemnation, but on the other hand the free gift arose, from the many transgressions resulting in justification. What was it to be justified again? Just as if I'd never what? Never sinned. For by the transgression, verse 17 says, of the one, death reigned through one. Much more those who receive the abundance of the grace and of the gift of righteousness will reign in life through the one, Jesus Christ. Christ came to give us life. Where Adam had brought death through his disobedience, Christ through his obedience will give us life. So verse 18 says, so then, as through one transgression there resulted condemnation to all men, even so, through one act of righteousness, there resulted justification of life to all men. For as through one man's disobedience, it says, the many were made sinners, even so, through one, the obedience of one, the one, the many will be made righteous. There's a really the real foundational truth of the gospel that permeate. I mean, this is should be in every theology that is taught. Doesn't matter what sect, what group of Christians you gather with. If we don't understand it's Christ that brought a free gift to make us right with God. He paid for it. It wasn't free to him. It was free. It's freely offered to us, but it was costly to God. It cost him his only begotten son. But that gift is so great that we can't leave that out of our theology. We cannot neglect the fact that it was a gift what God gave to make us, well, to administer the antidote to death, spiritual death, that has spread to touched every man. God says, let me fix that. Now, some of you say, why didn't he just not put the tree? You know, if he could have left out that tree of the knowledge of good and evil, right? Then Adam and Eve wouldn't have blown it. They wouldn't have got kicked out. They would still be in fellowship with God. We'd all be born into this consciousness with God. They would have passed on that life to us. We wouldn't have to be born again. We would have already, like, we would have come that way, right? What's the problem with that? What's that? Someone said it. No choice. See, God could have done that. And we would have been his creation. We would have been created in his likeness. And we would have walked in fellowship with him. But we wouldn't have a choice. Might as well just make robots. You know, when it comes, this is a really interesting thing about the love of God. God says, I love you unconditionally. But does he demand that we love him back? No, that's our choice. He does not make us love him. We have a choice. We can say, no, I don't want to. But see, this is what makes real love love. Think about a couple dating. If the couple's dating and the guy says, you know, I love you unconditionally. She goes, I don't like you. Did that ever happen? I mean, come on. It can happen. Or the other way around. It might be the other person wearing the shoes. It could be, she's loving unconditionally, and he's going, nope. But what about when the guy loves her and she responds to that love? You know, like, oh, right, finally it got me one that loves me the way I am. I like that. And the Bible says we learned how to love because Christ first loved us. He showed us his love. And he didn't say, I love you if you do this, if you go to church every week, if you get attendance stickers, if you give money to the church, if you go on missions, if you do, you know how churches have, some churches, I think, they forgot to read this book. They make up all these rules for God that are not in here. They are not. What do you have to do to get everlasting life, according to this book? It says it's a free gift, right? Offered to you. What? Okay, here's a free gift. God says, I'm going to give you salvation. It's a gift. Would you like it? That's it. One thing, accept it. It's like any gift. I'm giving it to you. You just have to take it. If you say, I don't know. What's the case? I don't know. I'm not taking it until maybe I could earn it. Can you earn that gift? There is no way we could pay. It's a gift. Just take it. Receive that gift. It's freely offered to you. It wasn't free. It's very valuable. I mean, how much value would you put on everlasting life? On a new body. Last week I mentioned we're all going to get upgrades. You know, we're going to get new bodies. I got home, I had Dottie and a couple of the gals came over and helped wash the dishes from the feeding that we do. And they were all talking. I could hear them. They're like, oh, we can't wait to go after today's sermon, man. We want to go to heaven and get new bodies. No more pain. No more suffering. Anyone down for this upgrade? I mean, does this sound good? To get a body made by God? Eternal in the heavens, it's immortal, incorruptible. I'm like, yes, sign me up. But see, it cost him his son to pay the payment for death that had spread to all men. And the Bible teaches us that the life is in the blood and that that blood has to be sacrificed. And the sacrifice has to be a pure, perfect lamb. That's why it was such a big deal when John the Baptist said, behold, the Lamb of God, who does what? Takes away the sins of the world. That guy is a really important guy. He came to take away our sin. And that gift, what he gives, is so much greater than the transgression, what Adam did. But see, in theology, do we teach that? Do we emphasize how great the gift is, that the gift is even greater than the transgression? That's what Paul is teaching here, by the way. This chapter ends teaching us that that gift, what Christ made available, trumps the sin and the death that Adam brought through his disobedience. And because now we have a choice, God has now made it where the people who choose to love him back, it's kind of like that relationship with the couple. When the girl says, finds out he loves her unconditionally, and she goes, I'm in. She's not loving him because he's making her. She's just responding to his unconditional love, saying, I'll take that. And that's what God wants with us. A people that says, yeah, I found out you love me even while I was yet a sinner. And I don't know about you, but when you find out he loved you even just the way you were. By the way, he loves you so much he doesn't want to leave you the way you were. I'm just throwing that out there. He accepts you the way you are, but he also knows how to help you and give you a helping hand up. Maybe there's some things you're stuck in. Maybe there's some flaws in your character. Maybe there's some refining that needs to go on. He loves you so much, he takes you the way you are, and he walks with you, and it says he begins a work in you. And he's faithful. Whatever work he has begun in you, it says he will complete it. Amen. We're all works in progress. But isn't that good news for our faith? That the gift is greater than the transgression, and the guy who paid the price for that gift made sure that we could all be brought to God freely, or of our own free will. Don't ever feel like compulsion, like some preacher's making you come to God. The Bible says nobody can come to God unless the Spirit of God draws them anyway. You know, it's God's work in our lives. It's funny how I've been preaching on things, and sometimes not even about this topic, and someone goes, I need to come to God. And you're like, that wasn't the message today. Well, that's all I heard. You know, the whole time you're preaching, you could be on a different topic, and God is talking to them. You need to come to me of your own free will. And you know how there's some people more stubborn than others? You ever run into them? Yeah. Nah, I don't know anybody like that. Yeah. Like Blake Shelton does. Me. Dottie. She's using slang she's not supposed to use in church. Good thing you guys don't speak Italian, mostly. She was married to an Italian, I know. I can tell from some of the things she comes up with. But let me tell you, we can be stubborn. And God will still work with us. And he'll work on us. And he'll say, come to me. Now, Paul wants us to know how great this gift is. It's so great. Trumps completely the sin and death that Adam brought into the world. And the end of the chapter actually ends with this verse. It says, the law came in so that transgression would increase. But where sin increased, we need to know this, and we're going to pick up with this next week. Grace increased all the more. So that as sin reigned in death through, it says, even so grace would reign through righteousness to eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Even so, grace is going to reign through righteousness to eternal life. Anyone down for this? We have grace to reign now in our lives, to bring us to what we need. God is so kind. He goes, I'm going to give you grace to get you through this. And we all need grace. You know, I love this story because this part here, the sister passage is found in Corinthians. And in the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 15, Paul talks about how in verse 45, the first Adam, he calls him, this first man, Adam, became a living soul. And the last Adam, this makes more sense once you know the Hebrew, but the last Adam became a life-giving spirit. The first one was made alive. His soul was alive to God. But when he sinned, that part of him died. So the second Adam came along and said, let me give you life to your spirit. The life-giving spirit is Jesus. He says, now there's a difference. There's the earthly man and there's the spiritual man. And Paul goes on to tell the church at Corinth about these two. There's a mystery. He says, the first man in verse 47 is from the earth, earthy. The second man is from heaven. And as the earthy, so are also those who are earthy. And as is the heavenly, so are also those that are heavenly. He says, just as we born the image of the earthly, so also we get to bear the image of the heavenly. I like this part. Yet you're stuck bearing this image of earthly flesh right now. But don't worry. Someday we upgrade to heavenly, a heavenly body. Now he says, I say this, brethren, verse 50, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. Nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. But I tell you, behold, a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we all shall be changed. How many know this verse? In the moment, in the twinkling of an eye. Someone asked me where I got this idea that we're going to change. A twinkle of your eye is just as fast as light. That little, you know, that little sparkle sometimes. They put it in movies sometimes, you know, the little effect. Ding, the little light reflects off there. That little flash of light. Faster than that. But light travels 186,000 miles per second, and it's pretty fast. In this moment, at the last trumpet, it says that for the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed. For this perishable must put on imperishable. This mortal must put on immortality. It says, but when the perishable will have put on the imperishable, and this mortal will have put on the immortality, then will come about the saying what is written, death is swallowed up in victory. Ah. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? For the sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your toil is not in vain. You know, guys, sometimes people, they grow weary of well-doing and they forget. We're going to get paid. I mean, recompensed, rewarded. Pick whatever one you want. It's going to be like a rewards banquet, okay? For the believers, when we get to heaven and we have that judgment seat of God thing going on, and he separates the sheep from the goats, and the sheep, he says, well done, good and faithful servants. Enter into my rest. And when I was hungry, you fed me. When I was thirsty, you gave me to drink. When I was sick and in prison, you visited me. And they're going to say, well, that's hope all of us will be saying, when do we do that, Lord? And what was Jesus' response there? We read about this in Matthew 28. He says, in that you did it to the least of my brethren, you did it to me. Your efforts, what you do to help others down here, don't worry. You're going to be rewarded from the Lord himself. Now, to the other ones, he's going to say, depart from me, you workers of iniquity, the goats. I never knew you. Leave. You didn't feed me when I was hungry. You didn't give me to drink when I was thirsty. You didn't visit me. And they'll say, well, when? They ask the same question. When did we see you sick? When did we see you in prison? When did we see you hungry? In that you didn't do it to the least of my brethren. How important is the whole second part of the command? Love your neighbor as your what? Self. In that you didn't even do it to your neighbor who you could see. You didn't do it to me. Depart. I never knew you. It's funny how showing that we really know God comes down to a practical expression of, do we help those that God has put around us? Do we, you know, I had a call, someone called me yesterday and asked what time our church is, where we have it, you know, and I said, will we have church on the beach? We start with, you know, the services at 9, the worship time and the praise to God and time in his word. But it's preceded by a feeding of, we feed the homeless, whoever, anyone in the body is welcome to come and just share the love of God with those that are less fortunate. There's a couple that brings a rack and puts out clothing, and this person went, huh. And they, you know, you can tell when someone's interested because they're like, so can I help or what, you know, how, you know, what time was that? At 8:30 I'll be there, you know. This person just went, huh. And hung up. Like, I'm not going to do that. I just want to go to church. And I'm like, wait a minute. You don't understand. We're going to stand before the Lord someday. He's going to say, I was thirsty. I was hungry. And I want him to say to us, well done. You guys fed me. You guys clothed me. And we'll say, when did we do that? When you did it to the least of my, when you went half an hour early and helped serve the food. Or prayed with that person that needed a little encouragement. Just said a word of encouragement. Do you know that's when we show an expression of true love to the people that are hurting? Our Christianity has to have substance. It has to, I mean, it'd be like someone, girls, how about if the guy says, I love you, but he never did anything to show you he loved you. No, you know, special thing that showed you he was thinking about you. No, you know, you can tell when they really like you, right? I mean, they'll do crazy things. My wife likes certain, I remember going around the neighborhood, going knocking on doors. You know, it's a poor college student. Can I go in your backyard? I noticed I was peeking over your fence and you have some really nice flowers and she's in the hospital. Can I want to get her a bouquet, but, you know, I'm on the college budget. I went around the neighborhood. I spied out all the houses with nice flowers. And if they weren't hanging outside the fence, I went and knocked on the door. They're outside the fence, fair game. If they're in the alley, just pick them up, make a bouquet, go see my gal in the hospital. But if they don't ever do anything like that, girls, do you think they really like you? No. How about we say we love God? We love our neighbor, but if you don't do anything that shows it, you know, Jesus said, they will know you're my disciple in that you have one thing. What one thing? Love. In that you have love. When you show love, that's how they know that you really follow Jesus. And how do we show love? I mean, there's so many ways we can express love. It can be just a kind word. It can be a hug. It can be good to see you. It could be, here, you look hungry, here. It could be giving them the shirt off your back. Whatever it is, you have to show it. Let's don't be fake Christians and not live this, because we don't, you know, someday we're going to stand before the Lord. And I want you all to be going on the side where he says, sheep, this side. Good job. Goats, I don't want him saying to any one of you, depart from me, I never knew you. Wouldn't that be heartache? Oh, and that is not what we want to hear from the Lord. We want to hear, well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into my rest. Come in here. My Father's rest. Hey, check this out. Is that going to be a good day? Yeah. Well, I love this story. It makes me just rejoice in the Lord, because I know that this second Adam did a better job than the first Adam. First Adam mucked it up. It reminds me of when in the end of the Gospel of John, where Jesus, this is another one of those Jewish studies. I'm just going to give you the real Reader's Digest, but the Jews like these, what they call shadows and types and full circle. If Jesus is the second Adam, the first Adam was created in a garden, right? Alive, living soul. Through his disobedience, death came in. And what happened to him? Was he allowed to stay in the garden? Do you guys know this from Genesis 2? If you want to read that, it's extra credit. You read Genesis 2 and 3, the first couple chapters of the Bible. What happened to Adam and Eve? Booted out of the garden. The second Adam came into this world. He was sinless. But the Bible tells us that he took upon himself all of our sin. He let himself, he who knew no sin, became sin for us. And because of that, he would have to pay a great penalty of giving his blood to pay for our sin. So his blood was shed. Then they took him after he had died, and they laid him where? Do you guys know? In a tomb that was located where? In a garden. They put him in the tomb. 3 days later, you know, they put the guard. You guys know the whole Easter story. They put the guard to guard him. They said, don't worry. His disciples said he's going to rise. We don't want him to come steal the body. 3 days later, the girls are coming early in the morning. Who's going to roll the stone away for us? It's a heavy stone over the, and they got a seal and it's guarded. And you guys know who rolled the stone, right? They get there, there's an angel sitting up on top of the stone. It's not over the hole, it's open. They said, come, see the place where he was lying. But he's not here. He has risen, it says. And they go in, they see, and they run, and they go tell the guys. And I love at the end of the Gospel of John, John records for us that Mary, she stayed outside the tomb. She was weeping. Even though she knew that they said he's not here, she saw a man there, it says she supposed him to be what? The gardener. And she says to the gardener, tell me where they have taken his body. I'll carry. I love him. You know, I'll take him. You know, if it's an inconvenience, don't worry. I'll take him. I'll carry it myself. I mean, this woman loved Jesus. And all he did was say one thing. Do you guys remember what he said?
Mary.
Her name, Mary. And she knew. Only one person. That voice. Maybe she had mascara running in her eyes. I don't know. She couldn't see well. She was teared up, you know. Soon as she heard his voice say her name, she grabbed him. She would not let him go. He's like, let go. I haven't ascended to my Father yet. You know, like, stop. Go tell the disciples I've risen. Now, the second Adam went into the garden dead, but he comes out alive. The first Adam went in alive, died, and came out dead. This is the Jews like these, what they call the full circle. You know, the second one reversed. This is what we're talking about today. The free gift outweighed the transgression. The second Adam brought the life back into the picture. When Jesus rose from the dead, he made that whole gardening thing come back. And do you think it's by coincidence he was laid in a garden when he died? What's the odds of that? You know, in God's economy. Do you think he had that figured out? Yeah. It was just to fulfill what was written so we would know there's a God. And we wouldn't turn off our brain to know it. We would know even with our mind. Think about this. God worked this out for every one of us so we would boost our faith. We were wondering, am I crazy for believing in Jesus, the Messiah? Well, let me see. It's on every calendar around the globe. And the Bible tells us in the last days they will try to change that. Because it testifies of what God has done. And you know, it's ironic, but they did start changing this just about a decade ago. And it began in a place called Jerusalem. Where no longer on the Jerusalem calendar does it say AD and BC. It says AC and BCE. You don't know that? Before Common Era, after Common Era. Oh, give me a break. It's, by the way, coincides with AD, BC exactly on the AD, BC line. It's just that if you say before Christ to a Jew who maybe doesn't receive him as the Messiah, you got this blaring testimony that the Messiah was sent. And they don't like it anymore. So they've begun to change it. Now, it's funny that in their scriptures, it says in the last days that they will change the way they keep time. Because they don't want to acknowledge Christ came. But I'm not going to, no way am I shaming away from telling you he came. And that free gift trumps the death, what Adam brought. And that we can tell everyone. That's great news. When people struggle in their faith and they're just, I don't know, just say, listen, you just need to know how great the gift is. Better than the transgression. Outdid the transgression, hands down. And it has now made it so we can have life. From the life-giving soul, he's called the second Adam, over the one who had a living soul but died and spread that death. We all died, but now we can live in Jesus. Share that with your friends. Now, next week we'll continue. Because of this, Paul will say, what then shall we say? This great grace that's been given. Should we continue to sin so grace can abound, right? Through grace, I mean, it's abounding, you know, grace that we're talking about. You guys know the answer, right? Romans 6:1, may it never be that we continue to sin just to make grace abound. And we'll pick up there. And if you have anyone that struggles or maybe how many of you have been baptized already into Christ? Would you mind raising your hand? Just want to see. For those that don't know about baptism, next week we'll see Paul's description of what baptism truly means. How we join ourselves to Jesus, not to a denomination or non-denomination, to Christ himself. And I've shared this part every time we do baptisms, but if you have someone that's got a question about what's true baptism about, what the Bible teaches, bring them next week. It's a great part of the scripture. And it also has a empowering part to help teach us how do we live free from weights of sin. You know, does sin ever get a hold of us in certain areas of weakness and we need help? Next week I'll show you the secret of how to get free from those things. And it's powerful. So I encourage you to come out for that. Bring your friends that maybe need to hear about that, how to be freed. And for us as believers, it's how we can walk free from sin. So would you guys come up, the worship team, and let's close with a song. Let's pray. Father, thanks for this time, what we have in your word. We ask that you would let your spirit just let these words sink into us. Let the right things come back to our remembrance, Lord, when we're with friends or family that question what you've done. We just ask for your spirit's work to bring us back to you. And these things of your word. In Jesus' name we pray these things. And everyone that agreed with me said.
Mahalo for joining us. If you'd like more information about us, go to our website, AmazingGraceKona.com, and click the link to follow us on Facebook. That's AmazingGraceKona.com. Mahalo and God bless.